convene the meeting for the purposes of reorganization and to entertain nominations for chair of the committee. Dr. Allen?
Same.
Second.
I think that was...
What name was said?
I believe it was Mr. Brophy. And we have a second on that. Do I hear further nominations for chair?
Move they close.
We have a motion to move the nominations be closed.
Second.
Those in favor? Opposed? Staying, okay, I think we've got a... those in favor of Mr. Brophy assuming the chair of the committee? Looks like we have a unanimous vote. Mr. Brophy, congratulations.
That one's under the hand now.
Again, thank you. You know that. I appreciate it. Again, aside from that, I appreciate everybody around the table here, the work that we have to do. Let's finish the rest of the nominations that we have to do, and then we'll introduce a new member as well. Nominations for vice chair.
Yep.
Second.
Lee Willens. Okay, is there a second? Is there a second?
Second.
Any other nominations for vice chair?
Move we close.
Second.
Close. All in favor, close. Okay. And nomination for Lee as vice chair? Favor? Opposed? Abstentions. One abstention. Okay. Appointment of parliamentarian?
Maureen.
Second. Okay. All in favor? Opposed? Abstentions. Unanimous. Appointment treasurer, Ronald Christensen.
So moved.
Second.
Second. Okay. All in favor? Opposed? And abstentions. Appointment of assistant treasurer, Kathleen Boishier.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Opposed? Abstentions. Unanimous. Appointment of executive secretary, Jessica Bennett.
So moved.
Second.
Second. Okay. And all in favor? Opposed? Abstentions. Hearing none. Okay. Absolutely. Again, not to belabor the issue, but you know very highly of this committee that has done yeoman work for the regional agreement. 30-year agreement, we were able to get consensus in all towns, and one of that was dealing with the consensus of the towns, as well as Hubbardston receiving another member. We have a board now of 15, and we have Jason LeClaire. Welcome, Jason.
Thank you.
We also will have a form that goes around in regards to our subcommittees. Feel free to sign up for subcommittee, let you get involved. Jessica will also speak with you to set you up to take a course. And 6-8, it's a course that could be taken here or along with the school committee association. Mm-hmm. As a school committee member, there's an obligation for us to complete a course as our roles and responsibilities as a school committee member. We welcome you. People around this table will do the best to represent the district and our policies, as well as our budget and our obligations to make sure we meet the mission and the vision. Thank you for participating on this committee.
Glad to be here. Thank you.
It's a pretty close vote for you, man.
It was pretty close, yeah. It's
And again, thank you, and we'll go through the business of the agenda. I know we have a lot of the agenda, and we'll get through it. So, thank you, Tex.
Hey, buddy. We'll stick together.
Okay. At your place, as well, it was given to you as a emailed to you as well. We have two sets of minutes for approval. May 14th. Let's look at that one first. At your place. Your second.
Yep, second.
Okay. Any additions, omissions, potential deletions, or corrections? Seeing and hearing none, all in favor? Opposed? Abstentions. And you have May 28th minutes.
Move to accept.
Okay.
Second.
Second. As you have read and looked at, any corrections, potential omissions, any deletions? Seeing and hearing none, all in favor? Opposed? And abstentions. Two abstentions. Fantastic. Superintendent of Reports.
Mr. Chairman, I would just like to recognize the administration across the district for providing the, I think, a very fine closing of our school year, to also make a point of thanking all of the high school staff for putting together what was a stunning graduation with perfection of behavior that was really I certainly commend that class of 2015 for representing us in absolutely extraordinary fashion. Additionally, I would like to thank the middle school administration and faculty for the work that they did to put together a very nice, shall we say, ceremony for our eighth graders who will be transitioning to the high school. It was a great event. And certainly we thank Mr. Wallanian, who represented the school committee at both the senior and junior high school graduations. And I will just tell you that I think we made a new land speed record at the middle school graduation. I was barely able to get some of those diplomas to Mr. Wallanian as they read the names.
And those that got stuck made it even more interesting.
Yes, it
stuck together.
Was true. And so at any rate, just it was a great school closing. You know, we've had some situations in that we have a budget. We have been to five towns and have five, what, I think this is the first time in a very long time we've had five towns simultaneously approve the budget before June 30. So that's pretty great. But the only questions that were posed to me had to do with our value on the roofs.
Yes.
In Barry.
Yeah.
Other than that, there was very little conversation about the quality of education, but at least we know the R value of some of our roofs. So that was really a great opportunity. I want to thank and recognize Cheryl and her team for the diligence that they put in putting together a whole lot of information about the budget. There's very few questions that remain unanswered should people read some of the documents that were produced by Cheryl and her team. And so we're very, very pleased and want to thank the towns publicly for the support that they have demonstrated to the school district. It is a very tight budget. We understand that. It will be a tough year to manage the budget, but we are making good progress. And because we have reduced force by attrition, there have been some transfers of teachers to various positions across the district. That has been a little bit, shall we say, stressful for teachers who are going to have to move from one building to another, or perhaps from one grade level to another, or from one position to another. So I just want to commend the teaching staff for not lynching me, and for understanding that eventually if we're going to reduce force by attrition, we have to begin to move around a little bit due to declining enrollments. I will tell you also, our partnering efforts are beginning slowly, but we are partnering. We have established a conversation with a couple of districts already. One of which called me the other day and said, Maureen, what are we going to meet? Let's get on this. So we have some real interest there. We do have some other interest from another school district. I don't want to say anything publicly until we, you know, really got things solidified. But we are seeing interest in, you know, partnering in order to save money. Because as all of us get smaller, the need to come together and support new and different programs is really critical.
What are we partnering in?
Well, we'd like to partner in, you know, we have programs that other places don't have. Can we have some?
A lot of them they don't have.
Yeah, yes, we do. And so can we, you know, find ways in which to manage ways in which kids can participate in some of our programs for fees because other districts can't afford to run them because they're a little smaller than we are? Can we partner in special education? Can we partner in professional development? And so we've had conversations with all of the contiguous school districts. At this point, at least informally, and I know that the chair will be sending a formal letter to each school committee chairman so that we can begin to have those conversations in much more formal fashion. So some good interest in our possibilities of partnering. And that's about all I have at this point, other than to thank the committee for its work in helping us have a successful budget year. And you have no idea what it's like to sit on the 25th of June with a budget. I mean, it's a whole, it's very busy at the office anyway, but usually we're struggling to say, okay, when's the next town meeting, and when do we get to that town meeting, and hope that we can get a budget passed. So we're very happy about that, and I do want to thank the school committee for its support and working with the school budget and getting us in a position where we could get you know, approvals from the towns.
Thank you. Before we go to the other business, if there's no objection, I'd like to hear from what? Oh, you have a question?
I have a comment.
Okay.
Unless you want to...
No, go ahead. Make your comment. Sorry, I didn't
okay. No problem.
Go ahead.
It seems to me that natural partners are all of the regional school districts. Do we... Contiguous, I understand. But what about reaching out to them? Because I would assume that many of their issues, problems, solutions, and so forth will be very similar to ours. You have been a leader in that organization. You know all of the people, all of the skeletons, all the closets, all of the good things that they're doing and so forth. Has that been part of the thought process at all?
Well, certainly we partner with the larger group of regional school districts as we look at legislation, as we look at state budgeting and ways in which to try to garner additional resources for regional schools. That you know, organization exists. I still am the president of that organization.
What is this, 28th year?
I don't know, it's a long time. But at any rate, and so we were successful in our work to get some of the 9C cuts restored. And I really give great credit, not to myself, but to the executive director, Steve Hemmett, and his work legislatively on behalf of regional school districts. He's the executive director for Mass Association of Regional Schools. They, and when we did, I think, a fabulous job pressuring and getting some $5 million of the $18 million that was cut restored.
Are they satisfied with that?
Oh, God, no.
You know,
we're never satisfied. We're not satisfied, but Charlie Baker just signed all he's going to sign according to his,
Are they going to stop it? They won't file a lawsuit at this point?
No. The deal was, and then we hope what will come out of the conference committee will be additional aid as well for transportation compared to the hubs. So we keep our fingers crossed.
So, yeah, so partnering not only in other communities around here, but also look at some of the larger regional organizations.
Well, it seems to me that's a natural constituency partnering kind of group,
right,
rather than Worcester.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
Or Ware.
Yeah.
Or, I don't know.
But see, Gil, the contiguous group is really important to us to share, you know, share more actively, you know, programming and that sort of thing. There's declining enrollments around us as well. And those declining enrollments, we have some square footage availability that's really nice square footage. Other places have some square footage availability that's junk. Some people have condemned schools. We don't. We have very nice opportunities. So we think we have something to offer. And so we're beginning to, you know, to have more.
Well, as we're talking about consolidating buildings, mm-hmm. Maybe there's an opportunity there, too.
There's always opportunities, I say.
Yes. So.
Good. Sorry, I didn't catch your hand, Dr. Allen. If the committee doesn't object, I'd like to go to the new business and be able to get that done. I know we have several requests for some field trips, and we also have our ROTC approval. So I figured that, and then we can hear from the French exchange trip update as well. So if there's no objection... Seeing and hearing none. Dr. Marshall, regarding the approval for the international field to England, Ireland, and Wales, as proposed by Greg Devine for April vacation 2017.
I'm asking to go on a trip in 2017. I'm asking this early because Education First Educational Tours, which I believe you received information on, allows our students to pay on a monthly basis. So it gives the sooner I know whether or not we can go, the more it spreads out the cost for the trip. The trip is about $3,000. We would go to Ireland and then go over to Wales and England over a course of about 9 or 10 days. We've gone with Education First for a great number of years at this point. I think we've gone with them at least 5 or 6 times to different places in Europe, including Italy was our last trip through EF. They do a great job in terms of providing educational services during the trip. And in terms of the supervision of the trip and all the logistics and everything is completely taken care of. It's a trip that these trips originally started with the World Language Department a number of years ago, and the World Language Department, changes over the years. I've ended up doing the trip over the past couple times along with Kathy Graham. But it gives our students an opportunity to see a different part of the world and see where their roots are from. We figured England, Ireland, Wales is something that can help in terms of our kids understanding their own background in terms of Western civilization as well as literature and other things. So that's why we chose that. So I'm asking for your permission to be able to do that in 2017.
Dr. Allen?
Move approval with the usual provisos, and I have to make one comment.
Well, let's get the second first.
Second.
Beautiful. We got the second. Now, go ahead and make a comment.
I think it was George Bernard Shaw who said, England and the U.S., two great nations separated by a common language. So I think it's great for the kids to...
Yeah, thank you.
Good. Any other questions? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed? Abstentions? Good.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks for doing that, Greg.
Request for approval... From Captain Rotzi field trip before the 2015 school year. We'll do that one, and then we'll do the Hawaii one afterwards. Captain.
I didn't hear the first part there, sir.
I'm sorry?
What?
Field trip approval for the 2015-16 school year.
Okay. Can I roll right into the Pearl Harbor after that?
Yes.
Yes. Thanks for the opportunity to come and tell you a little bit about NGRFTC and our plans for the next year. Would like to tell you that NGRFTC received the Distinguished Unit with Honors again this May for the 10th consecutive year, and we owe a lot to that. A lot of that to Lieutenant Friedel, who's been with us now the last 4 years and has really brought a lot of value added to our program. I think if you talk to your kids, if you've got them in the program, or if you've heard about her, she's phenomenal, and she's a mainstay in the program. And indicative of that, and some of the stuff that we have going on here, the numbers of cadets, just a couple of highlights here, and then we'll get to the trip. On the 17th and 18th of August, I have uniform distribution there. You don't need to worry about that. But the key thing there is, our unit will be on day one, 143. If we get the 73 people that are already registered for the program, we will probably lose some to Monty Tech and all, but not a great amount. This will be the second consecutive year that we've been over 65. It's bigger than what we want to be because there's only two of us, but 143 is phenomenal. It was 110, 112 just 7 years ago. So the school population may be going down, but the ratio of kids joining ROTC is going up. The 1st through the 4th of October is our basic leadership training. The kids like to call it mini boot camp, which is overstated. But it's basic leadership training. We'll be doing that down in Newport, and you can see on your sheet there who we're partnering with, Oxford, J.D. O'Brien out of Boston, and Durfee out of Fall River. I'd like to draw your attention to the 13th of November. That's our annual inspection. I invite you once again this year to come to that event. We get inspected for most of the day. We'll have a guest inspector this year, and we have not picked that person as of yet. The drill meet on the 19th of December, I had to come to you at the last minute last year when we decided to do that drill meet. We're going to go back again and defend our honor. We went down there and won 6 first place trophies in the overall first place, and they don't want us back, but we're going to go anyway. The 5th of March is our lock-in, is our ROTC ball. The 5th and 6th of March is our ball. You remember the tragedy of a year ago. We took measures to make sure that that's never repeated again. We did a lock-in this past year, the night of the ball. 98 out of 120 eligible cadets and their dates showed up at the lock-in. We had 17 or 18 teachers and administrators participate in that lock-in, and as well as parents, in addition to the parents. So we'll be doing that again. The 2nd of May is our annual award ceremony. Once again, I invite you all to come to that. That's our award ceremony, our change of command, and our traditional piping over the side of the graduating seniors. And then on the 27th of May, of course, is our Memorial Day Assembly. Don't have a theme for it this year, but hopefully you'll be able to come. It's an open invitation to attend those every year for you. We just came back from a whitewater rafting trip up in Maine. We brought 39 people up. We brought 39 people back, so that's always a good thing. And I'm supposed to be in Newport today doing Leadership Academy sail training, setting up for that. You can see that on your calendar for next year. This year we're bringing down five cadets, trainees, and two cadet aides. Those aides are cadets that went last year and did so phenomenally well that they've been entrusted to come down and help out the staff this year. So now Pearl Harbor, or Hawaii, you approved this 4 years ago. We went in April of 2012. We're going to go a day earlier, which is on Saturday, the 16th. We'll be returning on Sunday, the 24th. The I've got reservations, refundable deposits. Already with United Airlines, I'm using fellowship travel to make those reservations. The price is actually the same as it was 4 years ago, except they added $100 of fuel on there. So it's a little over $1,100 per person to go ahead and fly out and back. The rest of the trip is planned by me. And I'm using basically the same itinerary. My intent, first of all, is to bring 30 cadets, which have already signed up for it. I've got seven on the waiting list. And I have four out of the five chaperones that I'll be bringing. They've already been signed up. My itinerary looks something like this. We'll do a military history piece, we'll do a military piece, we'll do a cultural piece, and then we'll just plain old have fun, if that's okay. We plan on visiting the Arizona, laying a wreath there, raising a flag. The kids really learned a lot from that last time. We will do the same at the USS Missouri, so where the war started and where the war ended. We will be visiting an anti-submarine warfare squadron on Kaneohe Bay, which is where we're going to be staying, on the Marine Corps base there. And we'll be visiting a Hilo squadron there as well, a Marine Corps Hilo squadron. We'll be visiting Punch Bowl or the National Cemetery of the Pacific. We'll also be taking advantage of a luau. Outrigger canoe racing on Waikiki, and various other things. We'll actually be able to get on a Navy ship. I can't get one out of Boston or Norfolk or Newport, but if I go to Hawaii, I can get on one just like that. So last time we were able to do that, and the guy hosting us just happened to be, luck of the draw, a student of mine from Holy Cross, which was very, very nice. Each cadet will do a presentation on some aspect of the trip in preparation and appreciation for what they're going to be experiencing there. The cost of the trip will be between $1,850 and $2,000. We save a lot of money by staying on Marine Corps base and by eating out of the galley and box lunches as well whenever we need to. The luau is full price and all that kind of stuff there. So that's my proposal for the Pearl Harbor trip, and I'm asking your approval of that as long with the whole slate here.
Full approval with the usual proviso.
Second.
Second. Okay. Any questions? Seeing hearing none, why don't we vote for both the schedule, the outline schedule for the year, as well as the trip to Pearl Harbor. All in favor? Opposed? Abstentions?
Thank you very much.
Thank you for doing that.
So four out of five, so there's one more room for a chaperone?
There is.
So if any member is interested, is there a number to call?
Well, I have to ask Bob and his wife, the bus driver. I don't know who they are, but they volunteered to be chaperones. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kevin. Request for approval, Quabbin Regional High School band trip to California to perform in April 2016.
Good evening. Thanks for leaving me on agenda. I just wanted to start off by saying thank you for your approval for allowing the band to perform and travel to Washington, D.C. and perform at the Kennedy Center this past May. I just wanted to bring a little sample of the poster that was hung in the Kennedy Center. And as you can see, Quabbin is displayed, I think, third down there on the bottom. It was as Connor and the Andersons can tell you, it was a breathtaking experience. And the kids acted professionally the entire time we were there. Without fail, when I travel with any of the music kids, we always get compliments of how well behaved they are. They're some of the best behaved students they've ever encountered, all that kind of thing. And they performed with a high degree of professionalism. We had the great privilege of being last on the program. We were the finale act, and we received a standing ovation at the end of their performance. And it was just, if you want to touch base with Connor, the Andersons later, it was just breathtaking. What an experience. So thank you for that, and feel free to look at this later. It'll be hanging in my room. You can come by anytime. So I'm here to seek your approval for a trip that we've done twice before in the past. It was, we started this back in 2007, we went again in 2012, and it's a trip to perform in Disneyland in Anaheim, California. I think you should have a sample itinerary there. The dates on the itinerary are approximate, give or take a day, but the itinerary is approximate as well, but it pretty much mirrors what we've done twice before in the past. You should also have an insurance disclaimer in there else as well, and any other information. We like to use Suburban Travel as our tours because they do a lot of great work for us. Number one, they give us a guide when we're there for the entire time that we're there, an invaluable resource when you don't know where you are or where to turn or any last-minute itinerary changes. The students, and this, by the way, this involves band, chorus, and orchestra students of the high school, not just the band. We get the chance to perform in Disneyland. We get to see the backstage workings of all the stuff that most people don't get to see about Disneyland. And they get the full treatment of what it's like to be a performer and perform in Disneyland. And along with Captain Brennick, there is some fun and sightseeing in there as well. One of my personal favorites is just getting to see the Star Walk of Fame. It's part of our popular culture and of being an American. And to walk down that and see some of the names that we grew up listening to, watching on screen, et cetera, is fantastic. So I'm here to seek your approval for that trip, spring of 2016.
Dr. Allen?
Move approval with the usual provisos.
Second.
Any questions?
To get your picture with Mickey?
Only if you can find her.
You need to find her.
Yeah, we have to find her, yeah.
Tex?
I would like to commend Peter for his excellent work with the kids. For the years, give us support.
Thank you.
What Tex just said, I and all of us have to say thank you. You have gone above what you have done for the music program through Quabbin region.
Thank you very much.
School, as well as the elementary. And I really, we owe you a debt of gratitude, and I want to say thank you.
Thank you very much.
Please, thank you.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. I feel like I've really had the old adage of if you enjoy what you do, you'll never work a day in your life, and I feel like that's happened for me, so thank you for hiring me how many years ago that was.
Motion, and all in favor? Opposed? Abstentions?
Yes. Do you from the kids on?
Dennis.
Okay.
Dennis.
Okay.
All right, thank you. Absolutely. All right, we have the French exchange trip. Update. Ned,
go next. Well, bon voilà, here we are. We had a remarkable, I can't believe it feels like yesterday that I was here seeking approval for this trip, and we had a remarkable, fantastic time. Connor Nickerson and Maureen Whitney, alumni now, as they graduated in 2015. I'd like to introduce Margaret Anderson, who will be a junior next year at Quabbin Regional High School, and Abby Bryant, who participated as a freshman in the trip. We have some photos and a video to show you, and then I'd like them to speak for a little while about what they got out from the trip, and then I'll wrap it all up.
Okay.
Thank you.
Let me just get the light screen.
Sure.
I can start by saying that I had the awesome opportunity to participate in the exchange this year. And I also was given the incredible opportunity to participate on the EF tour a couple of years back to France, Switzerland, and Austria. And I've been given the ability to have a perspective of the difference between the two different kinds of trips. And the thing about an exchange as opposed to a conventional tour is that with a tour you can go and you see the sights, you see, you know, the Eiffel Tower and you see the Arc de Triomphe and things like that, and then you get on a bus and you go back to a hotel. With an exchange, you get to see all of these amazing sites, and we got to see very historic sites in the south of France. And then we get in a car and go back to somebody's house, and we get to go to sleep in someone else's house. So it's really interesting to kind of immerse yourself in somebody else's life, and it's easy to forget that it's not just us in Massachusetts or in the United States, that there are other people with completely different lifestyles. And by the end of the week, I mean, I think everyone can agree with this, that I was kind of thinking in French, and I had reverse culture shock, and was surprised that I could actually understand everything that I was seeing when I got back to America. So, I mean, it's just, there's more that you get from it than you can really say. And so I think an exchange is really an incredible opportunity. This is the website that I designed a few years back, I think before the EF tour, and it served as kind of a basis for updating information on payments and different meetings. There's some information on joining the website. You can join the website and subscribe so you get updates on new information as it comes, but there's news, which is just updates about meetings. The calendar included different events that the members, these are the members that have accumulated over the years. So it's been a pretty successful website. There are resources which are links to different educational websites for learning French or Spanish or different things, because it's not just French, it's an international club. And then on the French exchange page, there are pictures from the trip, so you can see some of those. So this was when we were in Paris. There are some of Maureen's pictures in here too.
Yeah.
I'm sure you can elaborate on.
This was in Camargue, and they were really famous for their beef cattle, you know, the horses and the bullfights.
A lot of the places that we visited weren't just like, you know, the Eiffel Tower, things like that. We were seeing Roman ruins. So we got the advantage of seeing Paris at the end of the trip and Avignon at the beginning of the trip. So we got to see France through the centuries, basically.
That's Nîmes and the Pont de Gare.
It's like France.
This
was actually the place that I was staying in, the home of the person I was staying in. In the south of France, they have kind of a lot of money. my exchange partner, his name was Gordon, I visited his grandfather's house, and I don't know if I have pictures in here, but it was basically the biggest, like, mansion home that I've ever been in.
But they're a very rural area as well.
Right.
So this house?
Yeah, that's the arena in Nîmes.
I recognize.
This was the driveway, the walkway to his house.
Wow.
Yeah, we were unfortunate when we were in Paris. We probably still had the wet boot stains and shoe stains. It rained. We saw Paris in the rain, but it was still Paris. We'll always have Paris.
It does rain a lot. Was it April?
It was, indeed. It
rains in Paris all April. The elevators all working in the Eiffel Tower now?
Yes, they
it's
were.
A long line.
Hmm?
There's a long line. You
right, we did not have time. With our 2 days, 2 nights and 3 days in Paris, we didn't have time to actually get up in the Eiffel Tower. But we did a lot in 2 days, 2 nights and 3 days in the rain.
So this is the video that I made. It's a lot of the pictures that I took, so I apologize. I don't really have a lot of pictures of people, but there's a lot of the sites that we went to. So I have different segments in the video. The first one's Avignon. That's where the school was. So we spent the majority of our time there and got to explore the town that was in. It was all in these walls that had been built, you know, centuries ago. And then I go into Aralamine, which are places that our school went on. So these are the, like, what did you call them?
The excursions?
Yes, the excursions. Yeah. So the French kids didn't come with us to these, but it was very cool. We got to see the Roman ruins, and it was just very old stuff, and it's hard for us to appreciate it.
Yeah, it's hard to kind of put it in a
yeah, because it's just, so we're not used to it. So then there's also La Camargue, which is my favorite place because it had tons of cows, and it was just really rural, and it was all farmland, so it was very cool. And then I think after that is Galier, which is where my family was. And this was a very rural town, too. It was right by the Pyrenees Mountains, I believe. And so it was just gorgeous, gorgeous. So I hope you enjoyed it.
Our trip started with the French people arriving at school at 11 p.m. on Friday night, and I kind of wondered what I was getting myself into. I was talking to my girl, her name was Camille, in English, and the first thing she said, "I don't understand," and I thought, oh, these are going to be long 12 days. But then as it kept going on, I just, like, I made such a great friend in her, and we really bonded, and then we didn't really see their culture when they were here, obviously, because they were learning our culture. So then when we got to France, you're kind of just thrown right in there. You get off the train, and Camille's mother was speaking French to me, and I didn't really understand, but I can't really even describe the trip. It was just life-changing. I can't really think of one specific event because it was all just really amazing. I remember walking through Avignon and just thinking, wow, I'm gonna live here. And then I got back home, my mom's like, oh my great, stop. You're not gonna live in France. It's unrealistic of you. But it was really just incredible. And I can't wait to do it again. And I think an exchange is definitely a way to do it.
Thank you.
So I think that my first day, freshman year, French class, I definitely fell in love with the language. So I thought maybe I'd fall in love with the people and the culture and what there was to see. And an exchange was amazing to do because I got to learn how they are, how they're different, how they're the same. I mean, they were very different. And coming out of this experience, I brought up my French grade. Pretty good to begin with, but it went up even more, and that rapid fire French at the dinner table really helped. I fell in love with the people. They were so nice. I got along with everyone that I met. They're wonderful people, and everything over it that I laid my eyes on was beautiful, whether it was new things or old things. So, thank you.
Do you two have anything to add?
I can add a little something. Like I said before, I mean, the difference between an exchange and a tour is that you're so much more immersed in an exchange. And like one of the things that I don't think I'll ever forget is when my exchange partner Dorian, who was kind of like the class clown, we were hanging out at a thing with all the other French kids and the Americans, and he pulls out his phone and he's like, "Oh, that was Obama, but he is so boring." So I think it's the little things like that, and you really get close to people that you'd never even meet if it wasn't for an exchange like that, or on a tour or something. So an exchange, I mean, I was surprised at how enriching an exchange is, so what's important.
I'm not really sure what to add to that. You know, I feel the same way as you guys, and it was just really an amazing trip. And you know, it was, I don't even know, like, what to say, because, like, it's hard to, I mean, it's good, it's easy to think back on it, but it's hard to put that into words, because you make such good friends, and, like when I was leaving my family, they were like, "Oh, we always have your bed here for you," and it was just like, oh my god. But I hope to go back there, of course, and see them again, and I hope that they come and visit us, and, you know, I hope that you guys go on it again, because I know it's going to be amazing.
Thank you guys very much. I'll just wrap it up. We do have a sister school over there now called Saint-Jules, short for Saint-Joseph. And they are very interested in doing an exchange with Quabbin Regional High School every other year. So I'm informally proposing that I, if it would be possible, to do the same trip in 2017 in April with approximately the same dates and with the same agency. This group worked very hard. We managed the trip over there 10 nights and 12 days for $1,949. and we had help from the Ocam Cultural Council and the Hardwick New Braintree Cultural Council supporting our trip, and we fundraised, and it was just an amazing experience. They worked very hard, and they deserve everything they got. It went above and beyond any expectation I ever had for the trip, so I'm very pleased, and I thank the committee for that October night way back when you approved it.
If I could jump in,
sure.
About 3, 4, 5 years ago, our French program had 2 outstanding teachers leave, Martine Fisher and Lori Monteverdi, and everyone, students, faculty, was wondering, uh-oh, what's going to happen to our French program? There were rumors it might disappear, and in step, Liz and excellence continued. So thank you for everyone on the faculty.
Well, thank you. It's my passion, and it's what happened to me when I was their age, so it's great to come back here after 37 years of not living in this area, and before I even got the job at Quabbin, this was my goal. So, and I do want to, I've gone on as many EF tours as I have, if not more, as exchanges, and it's apples and oranges. They're both great experiences for students. So,
thank you, Liz.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any comments from the committee members? Okay.
Yeah, when you talked about lifelong, that's so. I had a couple visiting a month ago. Either your girl's 15? Okay. She came as an exchange student with me when she was 15. She's in her 50s now. She brought her husband back to visit. Her daughter is in her late teens, goes to Catholic University in Paris. She came last summer to bone up on her English to pass the TOEFL, mm-hmm. which she did, and is now going to Boston College this fall semester. So, I mean, I could go be, but that's the sort of thing that happens. And why this is so good, in my opinion, is political leaders, like you're coming on Obama to him, but people, getting to know each other from all these various countries, the places you're, Ireland, Wales, England, France, you said you'd gone to all these sorts of things. That's how you really begin to build and understand, and that's how we get a real world, and not one that's going to be at each other, but where we understand and we appreciate and enjoy and interface and do business with and all that. You can go live in Avignon's a beautiful town, even if there is only half a bridge there. But this is the way it happens. And the energy, the effort that the administration puts in, you kids coming along, doing it just is terrific.
Absolutely. Thank you. Any other
Lee? I think you all have it's a great experience. I hope you all can do it again and you talk it up, and you know you get to see these unique situations. I'm sure you felt as I felt the first few times I went, when you know here in America you go to Boston, go to the South Meeting House that's 1686 or 1676, and then you get to France or Italy or someplace like that, and there's a Roman aqueduct that's 2,000 years old. When I was in Turkey, I lived in an area where the Hittites had built something that was like 3,000 years old. Israel, the same thing, and then you almost get jaded, like somebody will point up and say, oh, see that castle was built in 1100 AD, you think 1100 AD, what's the big deal? And then you get back here, and suddenly it's like, oh yeah, our stuff is like maybe 200 or 300 years old, and sometimes we think that's great. And then you get that perspective of going around the world and see, wow, now that's something that's great. And that's just such a unique experience.
Ed?
No, I'm all set.
Okay. You're welcome. The phrase that you said, life-changing, Dr. Allen is absolutely correct. The world is your oyster. You can go any way you want. And now you can also, and I like your perspective on the exchange. And not only do you have the parent support, but you have the Quabbin School District to offer these opportunities. Yes, you have to fundraise. Yes, you have to participate in the money. But I am glad to be part of a committee to offer and have the administration, with the supervision of the teachers and the personnel, to offer these opportunities, because these are life-changing events. and things that you will always remember your entire life. So, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Yes, Dex.
One thing that was failed to be mentioned was the fact that I shared with the doctor that we have had to change students, and they become lifelong members of your family, and you become part of them. There's one student from Spain that stayed here that is trying to set up her own designer shop in New York City, and she's, what is it, 44 now? So that you create this for yourselves, you keep it as a treasure. Wonderful experience.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, and I guess I'll be back in the fall to formally request.
And you will get approval.
Thank you. To formally request. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And I have to thank the parents. We do have a set of wonderful parents here, too. The parents involved in the trip were outstanding, as was everyone else. Merci.
And plus the exchange piece. We had front page news.
Yes,
and
we
coming
did.
To
yes.
Just, you know, to
some of it wasn't as nice as we were.
No.
All I know is we're good.
Yeah.
You write big cards.
Exactly. Anyway, thank you.
Thank you very much.
And again,
thank you.
Thanks. Let me just chew on more information.
Okay.
All those conversations that you and I had about French.
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
You were right.
They're living.
I would just indicate to his Quabbin Regional, we have some retirements in our English department. We hired a English teacher who's Egyptian and also speaks Arabic. So I know you're all ready for that.
Yes. Well, yeah,
awesome.
Thank you for the adjustment
you.
On our agenda. I really truly appreciate to hear from students and from the teachers.
Thanks for moving us up.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
Well, but no, please stay.
Oh, you did.
Okay.
I haven't had dinner yet.
No, we haven't either. I'm sorry.
We are too.
Okay. Great. Got everything done there. And Assistant Superintendent.
I don't have anything this evening.
Okay. Director of Administration Services.
I do have a few items tonight. First of all, warrants. Since our last meeting, the warrant subcommittee has signed payroll warrants 24, 25, 26, 26.1, and 27. And accounts payable warrants 25A, 26A, 26B, 27A, and 28A until the end of the year. I do have a few items that I'd like to update you from the last meeting. If you recall, on May 28th, we had concerns that we may not have enough revenue for this fiscal year to cover this fiscal year's budget due to the loss of Chapter 71 Regional Transportation Aid. I'm happy to say that we have projected that we will have sufficient revenues to cover, mostly due to the fact that, as we also recalled on the expense side, we had significant increases in our charter out tuition, which is offset by charter tuition reimbursement. So that helped us with the loss of Chapter 71A. So we will not need to cut the FY15 budget tonight like we had projected about a month ago. In addition, as of tonight, I project we may have a budget balance of $2,000, which in 20 years of doing this is the lowest a budget has ever gotten for me. So
does that mean you're getting better?
I wouldn't call that better, Dr. Allen. I would hope that I would be able to drop something in E&D, depending on how many expenses are out there that aren't encumbered and that we will need to accrue for the end of the year. We do have until July 15th to close out revenues and expenses, but we hope to have a balanced budget for FY15.
Is that by law, July 15th?
July 15th,
okay.
Okay, I do have a school lunch report as well. These are based on preliminary numbers, so nothing is final, but Mr. Boivier wanted to get in some numbers before he went on his extended little vacation. We experienced a 2% increase in participation this year over last year. That is huge. Highlights are that Hardwick had a 61.4% participation rate this school year. Our Ruggles Lane closed at 50%. I think you remember back in the month ago, we were very happy that Ruggles Lane hit 50%. They closed over 50%. Unfortunately, we are losing participation in OCAM. We've lost nearly 6% participation in 1 year in OCAM. And you know some of the measures that we took during the year to try to figure that out.
We have a projected increase in revenue, overall 5% increase or $35,000 in revenue. That means we sold 4,898 more reimbursable meals, or a 3% increase in reimbursable meals over last year, and at a 27% increase in catering. So a lot of the catering events that we had lost over the last several years, we're starting to gain back, which definitely helps the program. Plans, even though $35,000 is not a lot of money, we do have ovens that are down and freezers that need repair, and so some of the that profit will be going into capital equipment maintenance or repair this year. However, as of the close of school, we had $3,700 in outstanding debt. We need to take a few days to do our letter writing campaign, our collection letter campaign, and see where we can close out before the 15th of July. I did ask the committee at the last meeting to transfer $2,500 into the food service line item to cover outstanding debts. I have a feeling it may be higher than that. I've talked a number of times at this level, at these meetings, saying we need to do a revision to our policy, except I don't know what that should be. We have a number of students that were frequent flyers this year, getting up to over $100, $200, $300 owing school lunch charges that did not pay by the deadline that we set for the end of school. Do we allow those students to buy day one? Mr. Boisvert and I will be working on some policy changes that we may recommend, whether or not we can get them implemented for the first of school. I'd really like to be able to do that, to get them publicized, get parents and students to understand. This year we did do something different at the high school level. We sent letters directly to kids. We figured at the high school level, you're old enough to understand, you don't go to Dunkin' Donuts for the free coffee, you don't get the free meal here, and that helped us to get some of it. We did have all of our seniors paid before graduation. Mm-hmm. That was very good. But we do have a lot of accounts at the elementary level that are outstanding. So we'll work hard between now and the end of the deadline, July 15th, to collect those debts, and then we will balance out and know what we will need to cover.
So we probably need to update and have a discussion with the Policy Review Subcommittee?
I'd like to say yes, I just don't know what to propose. It's just so difficult.
So we need to kind of come back and look at that policy. Right?
And I would tell you that other school districts are in the same situation. When you have a seven-year-old whose lunch charges are $150, $200, and he shows up in the lunch line.
And looks hungry.
Right. I mean, you know and I know the bad PR you get, we say, "Oh, sorry, son, your parents haven't paid. You can't eat." And the problem we have is they're picking up their lunches before they get to the cashier, so they already have it. So what we would have to do, because of the Board of Health, is take the tray, dump it in the trash, and say, "Too bad you didn't." You and I both know that is not probably going to fly. And there is no, while we, you know, send them letters, we put them in collections, parents just don't pay. Well, the problem that we've run into now that we've had 1 year of being on this system is we had the students who were sent to collections. The parents did not pay the collection agency. The collection agency's hands are tied as to how many phone calls and letters that can be sent up for collecting debt. And the school committee, we wrote off the debt. Well, what happened now? The same exact students owe money again at the end of this school year. Why do I believe that next year they'll pay? Next year they're seniors. It becomes a snowball effect. And if the committee decides, and the committee can actually do that, but if they decide to write off people's debts at the end of the year and they start with a fresh account at the beginning of September, that's going to catch on very quickly. And like Warren said, it's very hard to grapple with, and how are we going to identify the student that you can't go in the line today without calling attention to the student. But we've more than doubled from last year, and that's a slippery slope to get on.
And I know that even Dr. Marshall has made phone calls to parents too to take care of the debt. We're not here to hurt a child, but at the same time, the parents have an obligation to pay. And we're not going to not feed a child, but we also need to help educate the parents to fill out proper documentation and forms, because if they can't get free lunch or reduced lunch, that's a benefit and they have access to that. So those are also, you do a lot of educational points that way too, correct? Mm-hmm. Dr. Rowan?
You said you want a policy in place by the first of school. It's not going to happen with the usual process. It would be mid-November or later. Mm-hmm. I'd like to propose that Cheryl, Maureen, and Mark can come up with a temporary policy that would then be presented to us for our approval in the first Monday in October, which is when we will be meeting. I mean, if it's that important, it needs to happen because, you know, it needs to go before the policy review and reform. It needs to come before the full committee.
30 days, right.
It just isn't going to happen. But if the committee would concur, as the chair of that subcommittee, I would like to propose that if the three of you agree and want to go ahead with something, I think it makes sense. I'd like to make that as a motion.
I'll second it.
Discussion. Any discussion? Yes.
I was not on the same point, but can you, like, withhold grades?
Well, we withheld report cards.
For seniors.
No, we withheld report cards all the way through.
Parents had to pick it up.
And we did get some parents that came, and we got some parents that called and said, I don't care. I know she's failing. I don't care what her report card says. So they haven't paid the bill yet, and I don't know what the report card is. But that was one thing we put into place this year, and it did bring some of the money accounts to.
So if they, I guess, you know, once again, it's getting through that. So if they don't get grades, let's say you're a sophomore or even a fifth grader, you don't get grades, can you move on to next year? I mean, is there a way to...
I mean, we can't, for a lunch charge, we can't deny the child access to education. Nor when the little 8-year-old is the one who has the charge, it's not the little 8-year-old's fault. It's not even the seventh grader's fault.
No, I understand
all
that.
So our concern is, and parents, and, you know, hopefully parents would care about the grade because it is an important, you know, sort of milestone as, you know, from the perspective of what kids know and are able to do. So this is a conundrum that not only we are struggling with, but school districts across this country are struggling with. I mean, you read in the newspapers, and the bad press just basically people get is when they throw the trash, you know, throw the food in the trash and say the child owes money. We've had relatives come in and pay bills, or families that were, you know, having some difficulties or whatever. We've had, when we said we can't go to the prom, that brought some money in. That certainly brought some money. So we're not sure if parents just aren't tuned in, but my gosh, we sent letters and we sent phone calls, and so
it's very emails.
So we're not quite sure about what would be the perfect solution, and that's what we will struggle with the chairman, should the committee allow us to do that and see if we can come up with something that we think will work better than what we're currently doing. One thing I just want to bring to your attention, and I know that most of you probably remember, but remember we were losing how many thousands of dollars?
$60,000
a year, and now we're making $35,000. And $35,000 doesn't sound like a lot, but when you think about the turnaround and the quality of the...
It's $100,000 turnaround.
Yeah. Yes. I mean, the quality of the meals that we have access to, not only from the staff's perspective and the kids' perspective, is very different than it used to be. Much, much higher quality.
So there's a motion. Yes, sir.
Further on this, I don't care what we do and how we word it, how we handle it. There is a certain amount of people in society, and I have to deal with that damn thing because of the border health. You know, I have people in court right now that it doesn't matter what you do to them. They're not going to be responsible for whatever they do. And this is the same situation we have. This money owed, they're never going to pay it. The only thing that Cheryl mentioned is we cannot let it get, you know, balloon and, you know, hurt us.
Yeah.
But I don't think we're going to be successful at 100% collection. No matter what.
Not just 100%, but we doubled in a year. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that's the snowball piece we have to at least look at. And you're right. Clearly, there are people that don't take their responsibility as they should, but we're not going to hurt a child or harm a child in any way. Steve.
So, I believe it was the town of Minden School District that they are dealing with the same problem. One of the things they have talked about, I don't know if it ever went through, but it was publishing the debt in the paper. To say these, you know, once you hit $25 or more, you get published. And it's, you know, there's the families like Texas that'll never pay.
Yeah.
But there will be other people that will not like their names in the Barry Gazette that say, hey, you know, so-and-so owes $120 because they're not paying for lunch. When all their neighbors know, you know, they can afford it.
Did you say Minden?
I believe it was. I don't know if it ever went through. I had a friend on the school committee on that.
Going further on the statement, Steve, you know, I mean, the tax collectors Put the names of the people who did all the taxes, so what the hell's the difference?
Yeah, right. Yeah.
You know, just put it on there.
Yep, our taxes.
I mean, it's embarrassing, but basically that's what you're trying to do.
Yeah. All the teacher salaries are public information.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's sad when teachers are on the list, though.
Well,
it wouldn't be for long.
I think you're right.
Good. So it was a motion. Do we, as a board, believe that we can at least have a discussion and take a look at it and see what we can do? Do we all agree?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anything else, Cheryl?
I do have a number of items that need action of the committee tonight. The first is the usual motion to borrow. This authorizes the district treasurer to borrow revenue anticipation notes during the school year. I have mentioned before, I will mention it again. Because we are using a large sum of next year's school choice money to fund next year's budget,
right,
as well as the fact that the final payment on the middle high school is coming out of a reserve account and the towns are not paying, our cash flow will be continuously strapped for the whole year next year, which we have not borrowed a revenue anticipation note of that for 3 years. Ever since the state started paying us our aid on a monthly basis, we did not need to borrow. We did not even need to borrow for our lump sum payroll this year, which we have had to do in the past. Next year, I can see us borrowing from time to time for revenue anticipation notes. One thing that I have spoken with the chairman with, and I will speak with the district treasurer, I would like them to sign a joint letter to the boards of selectmen and treasurers of our five towns. The regional agreement that Mr. Brophy spoke of and we spent a lot of time working on has a new assessment schedule that everyone agreed to,
right,
going from five times a year to four, and at times during the year, not July 1st when none of the taxes are in and no one can cut a check on July 1st anyway, but times that were easier and working around the tax times of our member towns. But we've had member towns that have not paid on time. And
we don't mean by a week.
No, we mean by months. And so if we do not make our mortgage payment on time,
we'll have to borrow.
Yes. Well, we won't borrow. Well, they will borrow.
Gotcha. That's what I'm saying.
If I can't make my mortgage payment on my truck payment, you know, Dodge doesn't call me and say, "Don't worry about it, Cheryl. Take 3 days." I get a notice in the mail. If they can't pay, they need to do a revenue anticipation note and pay. Otherwise, we will be even that more cash strapped with our cash flow. So I'd like you to talk with the treasurer about doing that.
Yes.
So that is the first act of business under my report.
Should that be the 2015? For fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2015?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, so motion is to authorize as written here,
yes,
but with a
change
of the date from July 14th should be July 1st, 2015.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, and second. Further discussion?
Needs to be 2/3 vote.
Roll call. Okay. Any further discussion? Okay, roll call.
Dr. Allen?
Yes.
Mr. Deschamps?
Yes.
Mr. Willannon?
Yes.
Mr. Kelly?
Yes.
Mr. Saravia?
Gorovinas, yes.
Mrs. Chamberlain?
Yes.
Mr. Hansen?
Yes.
Mr. LeClaire?
Yes.
Mr. Wiggler?
Yes.
Mr. LaBarre?
Yes.
And Chairman Brophy?
Yes.
The next item of business under my report was a budget transfer request. We did that actually last month. I do not need that right now, but I will update the committee as we close out on July 15th for our next meeting. We'll know where the budget ends. The next act of business is in something new for us. It's actually what Dr. Marshall talked about with the Mars group working so hard to get the authority to establish a regional transportation reimbursement fund, which will allow school districts to carry over any additional Chapter 71 money over to another fiscal year. In the past, that if there were any excess revenue for any fund, actually, it would fall to E&D. This would be in a stabilization account and dedicated to be used for transportation. We are expecting some money from the 9C cuts that we will get back. I do not know why we cannot get that number right now. The governor said it's $5 million. There's 84 of us sharing it. I don't know why we can't have our number. We're just waiting for it to hit the bank. It's supposed to hit the bank before July 15th, so it can be counted as FY15 revenue. And by establishing this fund, we will be able to use that for our going forward. There are regulations that you can only carry forward for 1 year, so you can't keep building it up and building
okay,
it up.
For 1 year.
It's like circuit breaker. You can carry 1 year's forward.
Move to administration's recommendation.
Second.
Okay. Further questions?
This again, we need a two-thirds because it's a stabilization account.
Any other questions? Again, you said it's a establishment, and the rules will allow it for only for 1 year to be utilized.
Here. 1 year's reserve can be brought forward.
And this vote also would allow it as establishment, so we don't have to come back yearly. It would be
right.
Established.
It would be established.
Okay. Roll call.
Dr. Allen?
Yes.
Mr. Deschamps?
Yes.
Mr. Willannon?
Yes.
Mr. Kelly?
Yes.
Mr. Sarabia?
Yes.
Mrs. Chamberlain?
Yes.
Mr. Hansen?
Yes.
Mr. LeClaire?
Yes.
Mr. Wiggler?
Yes.
Mr. LeBar?
Yes.
And Chairman Brophy?
Yes.
The last item of business under my report is an early retirement incentive, and I don't believe we have a need for that.
Hi, this time. I don't believe we do.
We have no money paid.
We have no money.
Okay. So I don't believe.
Plus that $2,000 will
get some ammo. I don't know. I think we're all set with that.
All set? Okay. Good. Thank you, Cheryl. Teacher advisory.
So I've been in the district 14 years now. Tex, that must make you feel young.
I don't have any comments from you like that.
Okay. I've never seen teachers work so hard in my life. K through 12, you have had a total overhaul of curriculum. You've had large class sizes. And today, one of my friends in Barry texts me and says, I didn't think you were in school anymore. And I said, I'm actually not. I'm at the Home Depot right now. And he said, well, seems like your building's packed. I'm like, oh, that's because all teachers, for the most part, you know, work far more than 183 days. I know there's PD going on the rest of the week. There's PD going on next week. There's people taking courses. And I'm glad the camera's rolling here so that some people in our town see that, because that's one of the things that's out there. And man, have teachers worked hard, but also they will continue to work hard throughout the summer. And many of them are going to be in a lot of different positions, and I respect the fact that Dr. Marshall acknowledged that. There were a lot of transfers this year. They were done in a contractually sound fashion. The contract was followed. Dr. Marshall was very clear as to how it would be carried out, and they listened, meaning central office, to our, I don't want to say demand, but our friendly request to get these transfers out earlier. In the past, because of budget things, it's been tough finding out late in July or August if you're moving buildings. And people, everyone appreciates finding out the news early. And there's people already getting ready to work in their new buildings. We had our annual meeting the last day of school. And no doubt there was a lot of passion in that room. There was a lot of pain, a lot of stress that Dr. Marshall alluded to. And I made it clear to them that some of these transfers had to happen. And I also promised them that their voice would be heard, that, you know, teachers like stability, and maybe some of those transfers didn't have to happen. And I just also want to be transparent in the fact that this is probably going to be something in 2 years when our contract is open that we'll be looking at. And that would be the appropriate forum for us to have those discussions as far as involuntary transfers. But I have to say, for being president for 2 years, Sheila, Cheryl, Dr. Marshall, Mark, we've always had really open, honest discussions, and I hope we can continue that over the next 2 years.
Absolutely. Thank you for the update on that. And I echo the hard work of the teaching staff, the support staff, the professional development. I like to look at it as professional learning, and it's professional learning for all staff. So I want our paras, I want our secretaries, our custodians, because it's professional learning in what we do. And some of us all think that we're at the top of our game. We're not. And we do learn every day.
Yeah, and the thing is, the game's changed, Mark, right? And that's what, if you're not a teacher, you get that. You're in education. But some people on school committee, you're all here for the right reasons, but maybe you haven't taught. Believe me, I'm still a young guy. I've been here 14 years, but the game has changed so much just in the last 2 years. And, you know, that's another reason why I think it's so important that we have a good, solid, open relationship between the association and the district so that as new things develop, we'll work our way through them.
Absolutely.
And I just want to emphasize one more thing, if I could. I would say every teacher that is upset, all of them, when they're done saying, oh, I have to go here, would also stand up and have told me in person and spoke passionately that we're going to take a week and we're going to have a rough week, but they're going to go back and the children and the parents will see an excited, caring teacher on August 24th.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And you're right. It's a we that makes it work. Absolutely. It's about relationships and goals and working together. Absolutely.
Thanks.
Thank you. No student advisory. Subcommittee. Administrative review. Nothing at this
nope.
time, really. Audit.
Nope.
Barry Building.
Nope.
Chow's not here. Budget.
No, I just want to commend Cheryl on the excellent job keeping the PowerPoints in the 20 to 25 range. We only went over 20 once, and that was fantastic. It was a good year. I'm surprised. I was at the Hubbardston Town meeting. Things went really smooth. Even though there were some assessment increases in towns, I think they knew that they had an opportunity for input early on in the game, and you can't bring it up at the town
meeting. Even in New Braintree, at an 8% increase, not a question. That's like a religious experience.
Okay. I went to OKM as an observer. Steve got up and spoke about the budget, and, you know, it went through.
I tried to fire him up, and nothing.
Barry had some questions about the R value.
No, with the logical questions. Yeah. But there was a
so, again, Mark, thank you for the work on that. And it's been, you know, and we are moving forward on that committee as we look for consolidation.
Yeah,
and
we have
adjustment.
We have a couple so, towns who have named somebody, but still not. How are we doing, Jess?
I think we have one more to go.
Yeah. I need one more town. We need that kind of a meeting this summer on that because we said we're going to do that. We need to make those potential recommendations for next year.
Right.
Steve has made those observations clear and said, you know, here we are again, changing the way we do the money, and we did that into the school choice piece. So you're already borrowing and putting more in the revenue side as we learn more about budgets and how the regional budget systems work.
And certainly, Tex and I were at a very long meeting in Hardwick where they were talking about, you know, kind of sharing some services in the fire department. And after listening to 4 hours, right, back and forth about that, I would tell you that the more information you can get out about any school closure or any kind of modification there, I turned to Cheryl and I said, I don't see it happening in a million years. No, they are very, very.
As a matter of fact, in the forum that we have two forums in the town, most of those people back.
I know, big time.
Yeah, big time, yes, very.
Big time.
I was very impressed with that, and the only problem is that it isn't more widespread. Yeah. If we could get it for the whole town, it would be great. But we'll see that in the future.
All right, good. So, thanks, Mike. Dr. Allen.
I'm wondering about revenue from the state, and I raise that because I see unemployment continuing to go down. I know tax reduced a little bit a year or two ago, but I'm not seeing revenue going up in the state. Do we have any idea what?
Well, the revenues have gone up, but the way they're directed is different than what we would like. I mean, they're directed, certainly there's a huge push for charter schools and there's a lot of revenue being directed there. There's a huge push for the T and for transportation infrastructure in the Commonwealth, and a lot of money's going there. So when what happens in Chapter 70, that Chapter 70 commission that's been looking at the foundation
right.
budget, they've indicated that almost all of the new money since 1993 has gone to health insurance and special education. It's not gone to the regular day programs. And they're going to try to address in FY17 that the budget will deal with increased revenues for health insurance and for special education. However, we worry that the new way in which we identify students who are considered in the lower SES,
yes,
that's going to be different. That's not going to help us, we don't think. We also, because we have declining enrollments, Chapter 70 is by headcount. So what they do is they call the safe harmless. In other words, they give you what you had, and they don't continue to decrease your Chapter 70 because you have a declining enrollment, so they just hold you steady. That's in Wachusett, that's here, that's all over Central Mass. So they throw you $25 a student. That's it. And trying to survive on $25 a student, what happens is we go to the towns and say the towns, can you make up the difference? And there is just no way the towns can continue to make up that difference. So we're hopeful that maybe through the special education and monies that might be forthcoming in, you know, for health insurance, maybe we'll see some help. But none of us are too optimistic who are in the central and western Mass areas where we have declining enrollments. We don't see a lot of, or even in the Middlesex counties, we don't see a lot of help coming there. Charlie Baker is not a big friend of schools. When he comes, the first thing he does is cut kindergarten grants. The cities, thankfully, are screaming. And I hear...
Congress committee still was still waiting for an answer.
Yeah,
still, for an answer.
But I've had some conversations with some people close to the conference group who say that the Senate withheld it as a bargaining chip for the cities who have tons of representation so that they can bargain it. So I think we're going to see kindergarten grades. I'm pretty confident about that. But again, the governor in 9C cuts impacted... Anything research says, our earliest learners, support of our earliest learners is critical. And then you come in and the first thing you do is cut kindergarten grants? We'll go, whoa. So certainly that was a whack to the cities, especially. But for us, it was a small amount. If they cut them completely, it's over $100,000 for us.
So you don't, we haven't heard from the commission, the Foundation Budget Commission yet, for their recommendations. So we don't predict that there'll be any type of potential relief FY16?
No.
FY17 maybe?
Yes, FY17, but depending on how it's going to be calculated, if it's by head count in some way, I think we're in trouble.
Am I correct? I don't know. I heard something about identifying students and of...
I can talk a little bit
about this
that.
Is a scary thing.
Because we could get hurt on this.
And so in the cities.
2 years ago, the legislature gave an option that if a school district's free and reduced lunch population was at a certain level, they could offer free lunch to everyone in the school.
Fitchburg,
Holyoke. Dudley Charlton did it as a regional school district. Well, now what the brainiacs to be didn't realize was Chapter 70 is based on income status. You get a certain dollar value for a regular education student, a certain dollar value of Chapter 70 for a special education student, and an even different value for a low-income student.
Yes.
Now, when there is no mechanism to count how many low-income students there are in all the regions who went to completely free reduced lunch, because it was based on the free and reduced lunch applications that are no longer collected. So now they have decided that the way in which they will identify low-income students is if they are direct certified, which means they are getting some other means of aid, Mass Health, WIC, those types of things. Well, in our school district, out of the number of kids that are on free and reduced lunch, only 35% are direct certified.
What's the state average? Are they going to need the state average or something?
I do not.
How are they going
to? I do not know.
Know that yet. Okay.
We were just notified that they are looking at a new formula by which to identify, which is bad news for us.
Because free and reduced lunch students in Chapter 70 are worth more than the regular day student who is not free and reduced lunch eligible. Meaning that because children who come from a lower SES are more expensive to educate.
So if we had 100 students that are on free lunch this year by application, or direct certified, we would get 100 students at X dollars, the higher dollar value. Well, now that only 35% of our students are direct certified, we'd only get that money for those 35 students, rather than all 100.
Well, that's going to kill the cities.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Although you tend to have more certified kids because you have more programs available. Out here, you don't have a lot of access to some of those programs that would directly certify you or your family.
So again, that answers the question that you're saying. You get some declining unemployment, but where are the money? It's being redirected somewhere and elsewhere.
So it was this past fiscal year for the state was record revenues. It was the most revenue they've ever brought in. It's a spending problem at the state level. It's not a revenue problem.
Yeah.
They have more money than they've ever had in the past.
Well, it seemed to me that they should.
And they do. They just did.
But we're just not seeing it.
Yeah, for the past 5 years, regardless.
I guess
of
they don't care about education for
schools.
Kids.
Yeah. Deval Patrick felt the same way. We haven't seen the money.
Yeah.
Right.
Regardless of if it's a Republican or a Democrat, we struggle equally.
Yeah.
You're right.
And Deval Patrick was the one who took the $18 million out of transportation.
Yeah.
We need an Olympics to come to that.
Oh, no, I think they're all banking on casinos, right? That's what probably they're banking on, right? Okay, thank you on the budget update. And again, thank you, Mike, for the work and everything else. You might want to be a chair again if you'd like that idea. Okay. Central office.
Yeah, we had a meeting actually before this meeting, and we discussed the solar panels, the carport approach, and Cheryl has done a lot of work looking at RFPs and RFQs and reviewing what the Brightergy had sent to us. Much to our dismay, it wasn't really as good as they touted, but that shouldn't be a surprise. More to our dismay was that when she spoke with the people in Grafton who were actually going out on the street and they followed that template to a degree, it turned out there were a number of illegalities, and they are now suffering some of the consequences there in Grafton. So Cheryl had done a review, found a couple drafts that looked okay and put stuff together that would include what we were looking for or what we are looking for. And she actually even put forward a timeline as if we wanted to go out, let's say, within a couple of weeks or so. And the committee, you know, reviewed some of the language, and we all had received a copy of this about a week ago, despite the fact Cheryl was ill. She got some information to us and all decided it was pretty dense reading. And our thought is maybe to slow things down and not try and rush into this. So we're going to take roughly a month or so to digest what she had sent us. Charlie had done a review. He's not here, but he had kind of done a review of it. He had a bunch of comments, and so we want to sort of digest all that. And if she gets more information, send it to us. We'll meet in another month or so and see where we're at that point. The other information that I think most of us have found out is that it seems like that the state has hit the SREC 2, has hit its ceiling.
It's really?
Right. So then the question would be, even if we kind of did a quick pace on this and went out on the street and got proposals, we might not have the ability to even go out because
there's no capacity.
Because right now the capacity is at its max, and the state is looking to increase that capacity, but you know, that's balls in the air. We don't know where that will end. So it doesn't seem to be, we're not compelled to rush into it. And of course, Brightergy will ask us, as all these others are. They're not unique in this. I mean, they all want to run and say, "Boy, here's the information. Get this out there, and we can start working for you guys pretty soon." And we know our history already.
But we have one piece online already.
No. It's still not online.
Still not connected to the grid.
Gotcha.
So even with somebody who we work pretty smoothly with, we had a document we all liked, and essentially we know that it's a tough winter, but still there are still a lot of problems dealing with these people. And I'm not saying it's totally on them, but they're just issues dealing with these people. So it's nice to say we're going to get 30% off or 32% or whatever it is for over a period of 20 years, but you know, until that thing is plugged in, we're really not getting anything. So anyway, so our you know, what the subcommittee is stating is that we're going to kind of slow down our walk. I don't think Charlie will be happy when he finds out. But we slow down a little off and we digest to make sure, at least when we go out on the street, we have, you know,
we're referring
we have
that
document
to you.
That we really want to go on the street.
You're getting that call.
I won't comment.
I'm only teasing. No,
Cheryl will get
it. I know it's frustrating. I know that we're trying to do our due diligence, and I'm glad that we are. And I just want to make this happen sooner than later. I do appreciate your work, make the proper adjustments. And we are keeping the due diligence piece because I don't want to, none of us are going to hear or want to participate in any irregularities or anything like that.
Despite what the dude at the Barry town meeting who was here 6 years ago in front of the committee and claimed that, you know, he had the panacea for all our utility bills, etc., and doesn't understand why Barry has to vote in $4 million for schools. I mean, where are we spending all that money? Okay.
Another thing that if you don't mind, what the committee was concerned about is when Brightergy came and did their proposal and they said that the Grafton had an RFQ on the street, kind of led us to believe that there was a similar project to ours.
they only did roof installation. So we're still kind of grappling with where is a carport installation that we can even look at and see.
There's one in Natick, I guess, I understand.
Right, but you know, more for us, it would be nice to find somebody who's actually either gone out in the street or a few steps ahead of us so we could say, oh, here's what we're looking at. You know, have you run into any problems or can you give us any advice? And we thought Grafton, you know, the people in Grafton might have been that group, but obviously, well, the advice they gave us is wasn't good. I mean, it was good advice for us. Watch out what we're doing. It wasn't good for them, apparently. So.
And none of our towns have contracts, correct? Our five towns?
Barry. Well, Barry supposedly is, but I don't know if they're plugged in yet either.
They're probably not. They were behind us. Yeah. Remember, we were supposed to be in that net metering credit with Kantaska and Barry, and they didn't get their votes in on time.
Right.
So they're together with someone else, but they're in a project that was being built after ours.
Yeah. On another field, they're supposed to be in another field, and we don't know if that field's being built either or has been built. The only other thing we briefly discuss is that over the summer there'll be the superintendent's evaluation will be sent, emailed or sent by snail mail to those who don't get the emails.
We all get emails.
Nothing against anybody. And similar to last year's, it's based upon what the state has put out, and you'll see it's pretty similar to last year's, and then a cover letter to or cover email or tell Jess to cover as to a date to get it back, but it's not going to be like a rush thing.
We have to do that, and then we report back in public on the dealing with the superintendent's evaluation.
Right.
That is, again, remember a couple years ago that was also done legislatively. That there's a formal mechanism, correct, for both mid cycle and a full cycle on the superintendent positions in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts.
I don't know why I've been reading in the paper about the superintendent and East Overshoe and Snowshoe Bluff or the committee that they're doing great.
Yes, that's probably why.
Mm-hmm. Good. Thanks, Lee.
Yep.
For the update. Collective bargaining, we're going to hear an executive session, a ratification vote for two contracts that are up. Planted facilities.
Nothing.
Meeting over the summer, any kind of proposal, anything you need to look at or want to review?
I don't think so.
Okay.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Policy review, reform, October.
October.
And thank you for the vote on the looking at potential ways to communicate better on what we can do about the cafeteria outstanding budgets, bills. Special education. That's Peg. Peg's not here. Technology. I'm hoping. I looked at the subcommittee. I hope people signed up because the technology piece, we had a former member that was in charge of it. That was okay. But we had a couple of meetings back in this early spring. And technology, we got many things going on. So there's really important things. If that's a flair or a strength you have, we got potential portals opening up. We got information to be prospected, as well as other professional development, whatever else is happening with technology and the use of, both communicating with parents, teachers, and the usage of. Am I correct, Steve? Unfinished business, none. Public comment. And school committee concerns. Ned, Steve.
How many hours? I mean, at the retirement party, you talked about how many?
Oh, 351 years of, for people who retired, they had 351 years of service to the district.
And some of them had 30-some?
Some, 30s, 29s, yeah.
It's a lot of years.
A lot of years. A lot of good stuff on those years.
Absolutely.
And a lot of good people.
Absolutely.
How many retired?
15.
Inclusive in the district,
yes.
Right? Custodian, secretary, whatever.
There are some who were not recognized because they're not retiring until like October or to November of next year, so we'll pick them up in the year next year. But really, we have a couple more that won't be finishing out a full year with us next year.
Steve?
Actually, I have four things. I don't know if you want to go through everyone else and then come back to me.
Just briefly.
So you.
Just to commend all those involved in both the high school graduation and the middle school graduation. Both those went off first of all, commend whoever was responsible for the weather, because both days were great weather, which is always nice, especially when you're indoors with the middle school graduation. Middle school graduation, it was packed. Not that it never, that it isn't packed, but I don't know if they could have fit another person in there. It blows me away. High school graduation is outdoors. You really can't tell because the seats are back. You don't know how many people there are. It was well attended. It went down so well. What really impressed me with the high school graduation is when it was done, all the kids hung around. I mean, they were around there for an hour or so. I spoke with one teacher who she was worried because she had things that she wanted to give out to some of the graduates. She said, oh, I missed so-and-so or so-and-so. And she said, 40 minutes later, it was like, oh, you're here, or 45 minutes. I mean, they just didn't want to go away. It was so great. And teachers hung around too. It was just kind of a nice milling around and people having fun. Middle school was a large class, but we did those.
We did.
We were pretty quick in getting those diplomas out, so that worked out well too. The kids did a great job on the baccalaureate on the senior movie. I thought that was very well done, and everybody enjoyed it. And it was just the whole process in both of them. I know the high school was more obviously than the middle school, but. I know there were administrators involved, there were teachers involved, and I just commend everybody because it went off pretty flawlessly in both graduations.
I want to say thank you for stepping up and doing that. I know I couldn't make it, but I appreciate everything. But I have an idea. You know, I'm an idea, Mr. Barringer. The QTRA could think about this. Graduation, and then we do hamburgers and hot dogs and ice cream for families and everything? No, I'm teasing. Oh, would it be nice? That. He said they mull around for a half hour, an hour. We could make it a two and a half hour fair.
Yeah.
No, I mean, Mark, you and I are always up for some good grub, so that's all right.
That's what I'm saying.
Something to think about.
Just eat one hot dog.
Yeah.
We can get him down on a D.C. trip to the,
the Great American Buffet.
The Great American Buffet.
I'm still recovering, Eddie, but yeah.
So, no, I'm just... but thank you very much for being part of that.
My pleasure.
And anybody else who ever attended, I appreciate it too. Ned? And then Dr. Allen.
I just want to relate a rewarding conversation I had with a graduate. And, we talked about graduation and everything. And I asked her a strange question. I said, if you had the power to change one thing about your education at Quabbin, what would be? She thought for half a minute and she said, not a thing.
Nice.
That was the right student.
Very good. Dr. Allen.
Yeah, it's sort of a strange comment, but I think it's worth passing on. We talk about the kids, and they go to France, or they do music trips to Hawaii. Here's one of our graduates, young girl, walking the Appalachian Trail. And one of my friends in Rangeley with my business up there found her Wednesday morning walking down the street to the post office and picked her up and brought her to get a shower and some laundry and bought her breakfast and all. But I thought that was kind of neat too. There's this young girl in her early 20s, by herself, independent cuss type.
I would say.
Wow. Walking the Appalachian Trail, made it so far from Katahdin to Rangeley and is continuing on. I found that kind of interesting.
Yeah.
It's Brianna Garrity.
Steve.
Yeah, I'll try to be quick. So the first thing is a technology. We don't have a chair for that right now. But for the past few years, since we've changed our software program, one of the things we've talked about is getting this parent portal online. And I know at the last meeting we had with Andrew, talked about getting that out, at least to the middle school and above, for September. Mm-hmm. I think it's time we get that online. We need to, we've been promising it for quite a while. It's important we move forward with that.
Okay.
Would that have their grades in it and stuff too, so that the report card issue could be monitored better?
Yeah. The other one is the redistricting meeting that we've talked about. I know last time we had met, we had talked of meeting before the month was up.
Yes.
Doesn't look like that's going to happen.
We're still waiting for it.
I think we should meet without the member of whatever town. If they're not going to appoint a representative, they don't have a representative at the table. What can you do? Yeah, I'm sure once they find out we're meeting.
What town is it?
Barron.
Barron.
Of course.
Barron.
So I propose that we close Rogers Lane. Maybe that'll get somebody to come up. Regardless if it happens or not, if we're going to propose closing the school redistricting and we're going to use that for the budget next year, we're going to want to know sooner than, we don't want to know in August.
We want to know in January.
January. We really got to start moving. And if we don't close the school, we can always go back to the townspeople.
Say we can pay.
We're doing what we can. You're not supporting the closing. This is the budget. I think we'd be much better off. So I'm disappointed we're not meeting this month, and I think we need to meet as soon as possible to get moving.
It will happen in July.
I understand getting the people there in July with vacations will be challenging, so we'll probably start with sporadic participation, which is always a little difficult.
But I think Steve's point is that may then act as a stimulus to get people there.
Absolutely.
When they hear
it. I think so, too.
And I know OCAM has appointed a member and backup.
And I know we'll make a call for Barry,
so
make sure that.
Case, vacation.
Maybe the Barry Gazette can make a note of that too.
I'll find a list in the Barry Gazette.
If we have just insert, we pull up. Insert.
Criminal sex cons, et cetera.
So my third item, I think Mr. Hansen spoke of this at some point during the year, was the fast math. Was that you, the fast math problem?
Yeah.
So the fast math, I think it's only for the elementary schools.
Yeah.
For what it is, I don't know the value, but it's an item on the report card, and I have a student's scores here. For the MCAT this year, it was a 98th percentile in mathematics. On the grading, mostly fours, a few threes in mathematics, and it demonstrates fluency in the multiplication division table of one. Clearly, the knowledge of mathematics is there. But the fast math isn't tracking along with the knowledge. So clear to me, I look at this as what you had said. It's really not grading the way I think it should. And to be honest, this one has caused an enormous amount of stress in the student's life. And I have no concerns. It's my son, unfortunately. Well, it's fortunate because he's got he knows and has the knowledge, but he sits in front of the computer and does that stupid program, and he gets frustrated, and then he doesn't want to do it.
Yeah.
He doesn't do it. So I agree with Bill on this. It's just a ridiculous way to try to score and actually put a grade on a report card when clearly that's not indicative of his knowledge. Just something to take back. It's not going to haunt him.
It was also the parents' frustration that there's no way to override it, and it was like that went in. They were told, well, it just goes in that way, and there's nothing to do about it.
So we've had a committee of teachers and administrators reviewing the Fast Math program for the last several months. And we've been meeting, looking at the use of the program, its effectiveness in measuring the student math fluency. One of the things that isn't measured on the MCAS test is math fact fluency. Math fact fluency has always been something that is important to mathematics achievement, but it was never part of the Massachusetts curriculum frameworks for Massachusetts until the new frameworks became, until we adopted the new frameworks in 2011. So although it was acknowledged as an important mathematical concept, it isn't measured by the MCAS test because the MCAS test is basically using the old standards for, it's a measurement of something that isn't reflected on the MCAS test. It's important for our students to master the math fact fluency, not so much to be successful in elementary math, but to be successful in higher levels of mathematics, in algebra, and especially in algebra. So it is something that we've been working on as a district since the new frameworks came out to ensure that our students are fluent with their math facts. The committee has looked at the fast use of the fast math program. We've looked at other programs that measure math fact fluency as well. The committee just wrote a recommendation to Dr. Marshall and myself to temporarily discontinue the use of the fast math program. but to measure math effect fluency in other ways. One of the things that the committee did to assess the quality of the Fast Math program was to give paper and pencil math effect fluency tests, which is what, you know, we probably all did for years, right? To see if the students did better on paper and pencil math effect fluency tests than the math effect, because there was some question whether the Fast Math program, which is used by many, many school districts for this sole purpose, was inaccurate in the assessments. And overwhelmingly, our teachers recognized that the Fast Math program was not inaccurate in the assessment of the math effect fluency, that our students were doing equally as well or equally as poorly on the paper and pencil tests, by and large, as they were doing on the math effect, fast math assessments as well. So it really wasn't a problem. We don't feel it's a problem with the program. However, we do acknowledge that the Fast Math program has a stigma now attached to it. Whether it's students or parents, there is a stigma around the use of that program. So the recommendation is to discontinue the use of the program temporarily, to continue to measure math effect fluency in other ways, perhaps to use a different electronic program to measure math effect fluency as well as our paper and pencil tests, and to use more measures of math effect fluency to determine the report card grade. So that's where we are with that right now.
Okay. Thank you. So again, our concerns are heard, and thank you for looking at it and making the adjustments, because we do have varying learning styles and learning differences for our kids and adults. Number four?
Yep, number four. So a month ago, when we were fighting with the budget before we came up with the one that passed, we talked about Nature's Classroom. We were told at the time, this is what we're going to eliminate. And the reason was, it wasn't because we can't afford it, it was because it no longer fit in with the curriculum. And it you know, obviously, if it doesn't fit in the curriculum, it's a good place to cut. Past week, comes home from OCAM, not only is Nature's Classroom not being cut, it's being extended, and now there's a payment plan in place for the next 4 years. So through 2019, you could have an option to start paying now for Nature's Classroom. So I'm curious, why? What happened in the past month to make this curriculum worthy?
Well, I wouldn't say that that's the case. I didn't realize that went out to you. So
let me explain one thing, though. When that decision was made to cut Nature's Classroom as a budgetary cut, unfortunately, I did not recall that it was because we have a couple of schools that go now. A couple of schools just went April and May. A couple of them go in September. The September contract had already been signed for Hubbardston. So I worked directly with the Hubbardston principal and said, well, we've taken the stipends that are negotiated in the contract out of the budget, so the only way in which we can make this work is that we do the fundraising to include the stipend amounts as well. And then the school of Hubbardston decided that that's what they would do. They would do fundraising to cover that. As far as I know, the other principals have been told that it's gone. It's a program that won't be happening if they, because OCAM, Hardwick, and New Braintree go in the spring. So it should not be, that should not have gone. Yeah. So you're right, thank you.
So are we going to continue?
Well, we're gonna obviously have a conversation with the principal, and I would tell you that kids love this.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm not going to say that kids don't
kids love it.
Great program.
They do love it.
Great program.
And the fact that we're away from the other responsibilities of the classroom for a week is sort of a problem. And I don't want to say it's about testing, but it could be about testing. And so there will be, I would suspect, some clash of the titans relative to Nature's Classroom. I think parents will be disappointed. And obviously, we will continue to work on that, but it would be our recommendation that it really doesn't, it's a great opportunity, but it doesn't really mesh with the curriculum. It doesn't?
Yes, it does.
Well, okay, Richard. I'm just saying that if you really look at it, and you look at the science and the frameworks and so forth, Nature's Classroom is even, kind of suffering because schools aren't good.
I would tell you, if you look at what happened to Sturbridge Village, it's the same thing when the frameworks changed. All of our third graders and fifth graders, we all went to Sturbridge Village. All the schools kept Sturbridge Village going. Now, there's very few school buses rolling up to Sturbridge Village and so forth. Sturbridge Village is really struggling. The same thing is happening to Nature's Classroom because it's not our shift. It's a shift in what we're responsible to teach. We know, and I know that this is going to certainly be, and we're seeing it with parents across the state and across the country. They have had it with a lot of the mandates and the curriculum and, you know, the state saying this is what you will be doing on day whatever because you have a proficiency test that the kids need to take on a particular week in a particular month. and you can't say, well, we're not going to do it that month. We're going to do it this month. We can't. And so Nature's Classroom is a time away from the, quite frankly, the opportunities for teachers to teach. And there are numbers of kids who don't go in this. And then we're saying, okay,
teachers can still teach.
Well, I'm just saying, Dick, there are kids who don't go on this. And there are kids who don't go on the Washington trip. And we have more and more of those kids who, and then we say, well, what are we doing with them for the week? And we try to do an alternative lessons and stuff at the elementary schools. But those have been challenging things for us.
I mean, kids are doing hands-on science. Why are we preferring that they sit in the classroom and listen to someone instruct them about science rather than them doing hands-on and seeing these things? I don't understand why that's not...
Well, they're doing...
To see that something real is not part of the curriculum.
Well, they're doing a variety of things. There's no question. Some of it has to do with science. Some of it has to do with problem-solving. So they're doing a variety of things.
Environment. Social gatherings. Yeah. All that.
Yeah, well, I don't dispute that. I'm just saying that when you look at what are the responsibilities the district has to deliver what level of curriculum during what time frame, that's our problem. We can't say we're not going to give the proficiency test this month, this date. When they do the writing, okay, they just basically tell you, we're going to do the long composition on one or two of these days. That's it. You can't just say, well, we're not doing it then. When we had the snow day issue, the state had to get all with us and say, okay, when are we going to have the tests because you've missed so many days? And so there's no question when we miss days at Nature's Classroom, those are days that we can't make up to get ready for the various proficiencies we have to take.
Jason. Listening to the previous presenters earlier about the band and the exchange student program, how is that different than...
Well, they actually, by the time you're done with 10th grade, you don't take any more tests, any proficiencies, okay? That may change in part. We may have an 11th grade thing. You take your SATs, your PSATs, but it's a lot more flexibility.
And they go on school vacation. They go on school vacation.
Yeah, sure. Well, they do, but I'm just saying that usually we cheat a little on one end or the other.
Yeah.
But they do go on school vacation.
Is there a way to go to June for Nature's Classroom at the beginning of June?
Mm-hmm. Probably.
So the testing is pretty much over at that point, right?
Yeah.
So that's a possibility.
Oh, listen, you guys are in charge. If you want to have Nature's Classroom happen and everything is then funded by fundraising, that's a decision. I'm not going to fall on the sword over. It's not a bad thing to have a Nature's Classroom. It is just some of the Nature's Classroom's experiences. I've been to Nature's Classroom. I've gone there when the kids go there at times and so forth. And there are some wonderful things that happen. There are not some wonderful things. But I believe our teachers work really hard to ensure that they pick the right Nature's Classroom things. Some go to the ocean. Some go to sort of a deciduous forest environment and so forth. So there are some different experiences. Some of the experiences just being away from home. Sometimes
for
the kids, the first big away from home.
Dave, I know with the OCAM, the Braintree and Hardwick group, it's a combination of things. It's a rite of passage, mm-hmm. it's a way for them to become familiar with peers that they're going to come in contact with in the seventh grade. And it's after the MCAS in May.
Yeah.
So it was always...
Some of the others aren't. Some of the others
right.
are in the fall.
And I know the teachers that go, and they value the program a lot, and I think a lot of it has to do not just with the curriculum, but the social interaction piece, the communication piece. I'm thinking about that girl who was confronted with this idea that she's living with some strangers for 12 days, whatever, in a different language. for some of those kids that go to Nature's Classroom, this is as big a step for them, and when they come back, they have done it, they've mastered it, and they've got confidence they wouldn't have otherwise. I really firmly support this idea of Nature's Classroom. In late May, early June, when the testing is done, I feel bad that the stipends are gone from the teachers, but if they can fundraise it, I really feel that the kids should have the opportunity to go.
Dr. Allen and Mr. Behringer.
Yeah, let's put it on review and reform and talk about it more. Is that right with you?
Well, I think that I would prefer to do something more timely, because if we're going to just authorize a go, I'd rather authorize the go so that they can begin to make their plans and so forth. So if we wait till October, that will really be a problem, I think, for Barry.
For fundraising.
So I'd prefer if the school committee would rather say, look, we understand there's no stipends in the budget, but if people want to fundraise, let's do Nature's Classroom another year and really investigate into how can we make it so that it happens, but it has little impact on the other things that we have to, you know, prepare students for.
I think teachers would be open to a reduction in stipends in order to make it happen, because they so passionately believe in it.
I don't know, Evan. I won't say that, because the only concern that I have, and I wish I had the principals were here, because we had, I think it was in Barry, nobody who had anything to do with fifth grade would even go. Mm-hmm. Because when you have young families, young teachers who have little ones at home,
right,
it's really hard for them to go
it
for
is.
3 or 4 days. It's terribly
people
hard.
Step up.
And so then what we do is we pick. So what we do is we take the teachers from the other classrooms who can go, and then with substitutes and stuff, that becomes, we can usually substitute the fifth grade teacher, but if a first grade teacher goes, we get a fifth grade teacher down in first grade because the fifth grade's gone. And so I would say it's modest. Whatever we pay them is minimal for what they do. So my only concern is that I would prefer to say, let's let them go with the fact that it's going to be self-supporting, that we're not going to take it out of the budget. We don't have it in the budget. And then, you know, we can have the conversations at review and reform.
Does the committee feel strong on that? Yes, sir.
It's probably the only thing I'll ever comment about. One time, a kid actually went to Nature's Classroom, went through the whole thing about 9 years ago. I still remember that week like it was yesterday. I loved it, absolutely adored it. I learned tons of things I still remember about the elements, about all this, the water tables, what else, photosynthesis, all that stuff. We all learned all that stuff down there, and it was a great experience, and it would be really sad to see that gone. My brother just went to it too, and he loved it, absolutely adored it. Yes, I know it's taken away, like you said, about the learning and everything, but if they could push that back, that'd be a great thing to not lose. Just
what I said.
Yeah, I wasn't against Nature's Classroom. I just didn't like the conflicting information that came from here and then came home from school. And I'd love to move forward with it, you know, keep it, encourage the schools to do it, but move it to self-funding.
Yeah.
Move it to self-funding, and like Jason mentioned, looking at the timing of it too.
Could we have that as a recommendation so we could?
So move.
Second.
We're moved and second. Any other further discussion?
Well, how many other things are we going to be selecting to the fact that let's have a fundraiser, another cake sale, or whatever they are? You know, this is a problem that's going to be coming up. So, you know, I think we're opening a can of worms by saying self-sustaining. Because pretty soon you're going to go to the other side. Oh, what the hell? Let the students pay for the education too.
No, but what was said, I hear you, text, but what was said is, let's you know, go to the fundraising piece right now and then come back and talk about it so it's not a dead issue, and then we look at maybe other recommendations to be made. So it doesn't go all the way.
Maybe so, Mark. Take care of you.
Okay. So, all in favor? Opposed?
And thank you for your comment.
Thank you. Yes. You know, seriously, we may sit here and we make decisions, but we don't make decisions in a vacuum. We need to hear from the administration. We pay our superintendent to guide the district with the appropriate personnel. I have representation from all other constituencies, and you're part of that constituency as a graduate or a student,
yes,
and participating in that program. It has to be worthy, it has to be relevant, and connected to the curriculum. That's our obligation. But the rites of passage, what was mentioned, is huge. Of what you said, about driver's licenses. How many, all of us in this room, the passage of a driver's license, the passage of going out for a 9 or 10 years old, the Washington trip. You know, those are all those things of life that we cherish as kids. So. Ned.
Yeah.
I know.
Sorry, can I ask, how does a self-funded work?
Well, in other words, they fundraise and so forth, and the parents pay. The parents have always paid pretty much the whole freight. And the district has paid sometimes for an extra bus or some time for a person to take their own car when something happens, you know, up there. So we've paid those kinds of things. We've paid the teacher stipends and so forth. Those have not been part of a self-sustaining model. And then we took those things out of the budget this year and said that, the marriage with the curriculum and some of the difficulties with getting all of the, you know, instruction that we need in the same, so we say calendar is testing, but we certainly can look at when can we go, when can we change dates and times.
So again, thank you, yes.
Quick, didn't you say that the teachers that go on these other trips don't receive stipends?
That is true. But in this contract, there is, right? Mm-hmm. There is a thing for Nature's Classroom where there is compensation.
I understand that we're giving their time, and I'm not against the site. I just want to clarify.
I can't remember what it is, but it's minimal.
It's under, just under $500
per person.
Historically, when that whole thing came up, I was on the other side bargaining, and I think it was originally intended to pay for the coordinator, a coordinator in the building, who was going to take care of the money, raising the money, and somehow in negotiations it got translated into a stipend for everybody who went. And as I recall, that was not the original intent. It was
listening to that.
I'm listening.
I'm hoping somebody else will chime in too.
But, no, it's okay. But
it was originally brought up to compensate the teacher who was primarily responsible for fundraising throughout the entire year.
I know there used to be that kind of a stipend for the Washington person who did all of that coordination.
Is that still in existence?
Yes. But there was an individual nightly thing for the Nature's Classroom, as I remember it, but of course...
I mean, something got lost in the translation, but I recall that was the original incentive for...
He's on the other side of the table,
I have a long memory.
And speaking of that, we need to go into executive session. I got to do a roll call. We'll be brought up to speed. We'll be out very shortly, I promise. So roll call to go into executive session for collective bargaining purposes.
Don't move.
For Parrot and the food services. So